And ladies and gentlemen, we conclude this morning's really fascinating discussions on the role of technology and digitalization with a look at a technology that once seemed like the absolute moonshot and is now, according to many experts, in reach. Quantum computing is, without a question, a paradigm shift in the history of information processing. Will it allow us to solve problems that have hitherto stumped even the fastest supercomputers? Or, to quote the title of our keynote, could it be used to change the world? Please welcome the Chief Business Officer at the startup Atom Computing, formerly head of IBM's startup program. She also serves as president of Women in Quantum, a rapidly growing organization creating a community for women in the quantum field. It's a great pleasure to welcome Denise Ruffner. You have the floor.
Good morning. I think I'm standing between you and lunch, but I'm delighted to talk to you all. It's been wonderful to be here. And I wanted to start off and ask you all, has anybody ever heard of quantum computing? Raise your hand. Oh my God, that's wonderful. All right, good. What I'm going to try to do today is give you a little bit of an overview of the technology and not get too deep in the weeds on quantum computing. So we'll talk a little bit about what's going on in the industry. So quantum computing actually was first thought of in the early 80s by Richard Feynman, a Nobel laureate. And he said, if you want to study nature, then perhaps you need to build a computer that works via kind of the natural principles. And he made that comment, and everybody said, you know, Richard, that's not going to work. And then in 1995, we showed the first quantum computing gate. And all of a sudden, it became like this might be able to happen. So I'm going to update you where we are today, but it's still a technology that's very much in its infancy. So let's go to the, I'm doing slides. I'm not used to doing my own slides, sorry. Just to talk a little bit about my history, I'm a biologist, I'm not a physicist. But I was lucky enough to become involved in quantum computing very early when the first commercial quantum computer was made available by IBM. And when I was at IBM, I did a lot in starting out their quantum computing program and was later poached by a startup and since then have been poached by three subsequent startups. So I'm probably one of the people in the industry that has the broadest view of the different technologies and the different approaches to the business. So it's a really fun business. Along the way, I did start a group called Women in Quantum. Quantum is not a very diverse field, and so I'm looking to increase diversity in it. We have 9,000 members worldwide, and it's my secret passion to help other women, especially in STEM. I also want to mention again that I'm a biologist and don't ask me physics questions or I can try. All right. Okay, so I'm going to talk a little bit about quantum computing and commercial quantum computing. What I want to do is give you context and then we can talk about what's going on in quantum computing today and then start getting into how quantum computing will change the world, which I think is very exciting. This quote by Fortune magazine is one of my favorite quotes. A lot of people say quantum computing, why? And I really believe that no other emerging technology can span so many different disciplines with so many potential applications. So we're at the forefront of something really big, but we're also at the beginning. So this is a new initiative going forward. It's going to unfold over the next 5, 10, 15, 20 years. And so we're all kind of, it's like the beginning of computing in the 50s or 60s. We're now here with quantum computing. All right, so. A couple definitions. So there's some very technical parts of quantum computing, and I try not to go there because it gets very complicated. And so I tend to think of quantum computing as just a new type of computing that harnesses the properties of quantum mechanics. And if you just think about it, it's a different way to do computing. I think that's the best starting point for this technology. And what's important and what we're going to talk about is, even though there's these huge supercomputers all over the world, there's many problems that supercomputers can't solve. And so quantum computing, we believe, is the way to solve some of these very compute difficult problems. And in doing that, will lead to a lot of innovation. And so we'll talk a little bit on the next slide about how quantum computers work. What's interesting is in classical computing, we have a bit, and it either has a value of a zero or a one. In quantum computing, a bit is a zero or a one at the same time. So it's very different. We call this bit a quantum bit. And quantum computers, each bit you add to a quantum computer exponentially increases the capability of the computer. So it can be very powerful as the number of qubits increases. So what the name of the game is in quantum computers is, how many qubits do you have? Now, when you look at a quantum computer and you look at qubits, that's an important part of the story. But because these computers are so complicated and hard to make, it's also really important how good your qubits are. And so there's a lot of different metrics that we use to look at a quantum computer as a whole. And what is huge in quantum computers right now is error rates. So there's a lot of error. And that's because there's a lot of electronics. And I'll show you a quantum computer my company, Atom Computing, is building. And you'll get an idea of kind of how early we are in building these computers. And so when you look at a quantum computer, you look at qubits, you look at error rates, you look at a lot of different factors. And so it's very hard to compare quantum computer to quantum computer. And we actually have put together metrics to do that because it's so hard to make that comparison. And you can't just pick one of these factors and use that as a determining factor. You need to look at a bunch of different factors. So when I got into quantum computing, I was actually working at IBM on high-performance computers. And at the time, the largest high-performance computer in the world was at Oak Ridge National Labs. It's the size of two tennis courts. It's giant. It uses 185 miles of cables. And you look at it and you think, wow, a computer this big must be able to solve anything. And what I found is that even a computer that big still has problems. And there's still compute problems that it can't solve, or it takes very long to solve. Now, what's interesting, if we looked at the Oak Ridge computer, which is now number two in the world, it's the equivalent to a 50 to 60 qubit computer. Now, this is a clean, no error computer. But it just shows you that a quantum computer really has the potential to exceed the capabilities of these huge supercomputers. So if I wanted to double the capabilities of a supercomputer, I'd have to get two more tennis courts worth of equipment. Whereas if I wanted to double the capabilities of a quantum computer, I would simply add one more qubit. So I mentioned that quantum computing is very new, and what we're all looking for is something we call quantum advantage or quantum supremacy. So where are the examples that quantum computing can outperform a classical computer? And to date, there's really only been one example, and this is some work that was done by Google in 2019. And it's very significant work in that it was a brilliant problem, and they came up with a solution, and it exceeded the performance of a quantum computer. Now, is it a problem that's widely applicable? Does it change our lives? No, it was a clever science experiment. But what we liked about it is it showed that quantum computers had the potential to solve difficult problems and to exceed the performance of a classical computer. Now, what's controversial in this slide is that Google claimed that it would take the world's most powerful computer 10,000 years to solve this problem. At the same time, IBM came out with a paper that said, it's not 10,000 years, it's 4 days. So whether it's 10,000 years or 4 days, big difference, I understand. What it still shows is that a quantum computer outperformed a classical computer. And this is, in our industry, this is what really excites us, and we're all looking for more examples of this. And we hope to see this over the next couple of years, more examples. All right, so now I want to do some level setting on quantum computers. So the first commercial quantum computer was first put on the cloud in 2016 by IBM, and it had 5 qubits. And it was really a funny story. I was at IBM, and we did this, and we said, nobody's going to use it. Nobody knows what this is. Nobody cares. And what we found out is that in the first week, 7,000 people registered to use it. We were shocked. Since then, there's over 325,000 users, and it's become a huge success. And what's neat is that people have reached out and embraced this technology and are trying to learn it and trying to figure out what they can do with it. Now, at that time, there were other companies developing quantum computers, and I'm going to talk a little bit about some of these other companies now, because I want, this is all about perspective. So today, and actually the slide is already wrong, but today there's 61 companies in the world developing quantum computers. So it's quite what we call a horse race sometimes, where there's a lot of different companies. It could be a small startup like the company I work for. It could be a big company like Amazon or Google or IBM. So a wide range of companies. But we're all kind of developing the holy grail, which is a quantum computer that will exceed the capabilities of a classical computer. I'll mention there's also companies that do software development for quantum computers. You don't program a quantum computer in the same way as you do a classical computer. And there's quite a few corporates that are using quantum computing that we'll talk about, whether it's in finance or chemistry or a variety of applications, a lot of research programs around the world, governments. So there's quite a lot of interest in this technology. Now, this is where the fun begins. So there are literally 9 different ways right now to develop a quantum computer. And I've represented them on this slide. And the bigger box means more people are doing that technology. But essentially, we have 9 different ways to do the same thing. And we don't know which way is the best. So there's a couple issues. One is we have people that have quantum computers that are usable today, but they're very small. And the question is, who is going to be able to develop a computer that we say will scale, so it will get bigger and bigger? So right now we have, let's say, between 5 and 150 qubits. What we really need is to get in the thousands or millions of qubits. And so the question is, some of these technologies are very good right now, but we don't know where they're going to be in 5 years and whether they're going to really be able to grow in the way that we think that they need to grow, or we know they need to grow. Oh, and I do want to mention that recently there have been some, I'll talk about it a little bit, some of these companies have gone public, and there have been some analyst reports talking about quantum computing and that quantum computing may not be real. It is a very real technology, but it's very early. And so one of my messages to you is, it's early. If someone claims that it's going to do something tomorrow, don't believe it, but understand that this is a industry that's growing and it's in its infancy, but I truly believe that it will show great strides in science. Now, I work for Atom Computing, which is a small company based out of Berkeley, California. We have 50 employees. And what our claim to fame is We had a founding scientist that worked on something called neutral atoms when he was in grad school, and then went to work at a quantum computing company and came back and said, I think neutral atoms would be a better way to build a quantum computer. So he started a company, and what he did is within 2 years, he built a 100-qubit quantum computer. And that's quite an accomplishment when you think about IBM, who did research from the 80s till 2016 to get a 5-qubit computer. The fact that in 2 years we got a 100-qubit computer is really amazing. And because of that, we've raised $80 million in venture capital, so quite decent funding. And we have 50 people, 50 scientists with amazing track records and amazing publications. So we feel like we have a dream team. And now what our company is doing is developing our next generation computer. So 100 qubits is a good proof of concept, but we don't want 100, we want thousands. So we're shooting for our next phase right now. And I wanted to show you a picture. It's a laboratory-type computer. Our system uses a laser or a couple lasers. And what we do, I'm going to just check ahead on what my next slide is. What we do is we actually heat up an element, an alkaline earth element, and we trap the atoms. And we use something called laser tweezers. And we hold the atoms in place. And then we put another laser on them and turn them into qubits, run our quantum algorithm on it, and then we can simply take a picture and we can tell which qubits are zeros and ones and get our answers. So it's a very simple and elegant way to do quantum computing. But as I say, it's one of nine ways. So I always try to give you that context that we're excited about it. We think it's promising, but there are also other companies that will tell you the same thing. This computer is the size, it's 8 feet by 10 feet. And the back wall, let's see if this pointer works. I don't think so. But the back wall of the computer is all classical computers that controls all the activities going on in the computer. So these devices are real big engineering challenges. And so when we talk about the race and how difficult it is, it's because we're pushing the limits of lasers, we're pushing the limits of electronics, and part of what we're doing is we're actually developing new materials, new lasers, new everything to try to push the performance of the system. All right. Currently, quantum computers are available on the cloud. So if you go to Amazon, or you go to Google, or you go to Microsoft, you can access quantum computers. You can access it by the minute. You do need to have special software to run it, but it's available to everyone who wants to run on them. All right. Now, quantum computing, because of its ability to change the world, is really getting a lot of focus by governments. And I think all of us in the room, especially in Germany, who's made huge investments in quantum computing, we're aware that our governments are all very interested in helping their scientists make progress in this area. One of the things is that the largest public funding in the world for quantum computing is out of China, and they greatly outspend the rest of us. So far, the publications we've seen don't indicate that they have a lead on us, but they still have tremendous pocketbook and tremendous momentum. The company with the second largest quantum computing investment is Germany, who's doing great things. And every week we see different governments offering new grants and trying to do new things to stimulate the quantum computing business in their country. Likewise, if we look at the number of startups by country, this is really hard to read, and I apologize, but right now the most startups are in the USA and in the UK. But we see startups all over the world, including in South America. And this is something we're seeing more and more startups in this area. And even though it is a while before we feel that people are going to be really able to capitalize on the work that they're doing, there's still quite a lot of interest and quite a lot of funding in startups, for startups. And I'm running out of time, so let me speed up a little bit. I've mentioned there's a number of public companies. That's something to keep your eye on. And what I want to talk about for just a quick minute is areas of quantum computing applications. So there are many different things you can do with a quantum computer, and if you want, we can talk about it offline. But people are doing problems involving optimization, where you're looking at, for example, supply chain or routing or packing a container, simulating complex natural systems, doing machine learning, and cryptography. Cryptography you're going to hear a lot about because quantum computers have the ability to hack today's current encryption standards. And the US government has just published new standards for encryption. So we're going to be seeing and hearing a lot about changing how we protect our data in order to safeguard it against quantum computers. What I wanted to talk to you all about, I'm going to skip this, is how should you prepare? So I think it's really important for each of you in your companies to understand that this technology is coming and to start thinking about how it could be useful to you. That doesn't mean necessarily that you want to invest in it today. That's an individual decision that many companies make depending on how long they're willing to wait for a solution. Nonetheless, this is a technology that's coming, and there are many people that are adopting it early because they feel it will give their company a competitive advantage. And so it's something that all of us should be thinking about when we look at our company and we do future planning, what we're going to do, how we want to handle it, and how we want to think about quantum computing in terms of strategy. So I will always say, please think about it, please plan for it, and take the time to learn a little bit about it. And then on the last slide, I did want to talk a little bit about some of the solution areas. I mentioned quantum computing will save the world. One of the things that we see a lot of quantum computing work is in the area of carbon sequestration, trying to use it to capture carbon out of the atmosphere to help with pollution. There's quite a lot of work being done. Battery improvement of batteries, making batteries smaller, lighter, last longer. New material discovery. Healthcare, looking at genomics. How can we do analysis faster? There's applications in just about every industry. And so we feel it's really going to be an amazing technology that will impact all of us in many different ways. And right now, it's only our imagination that's holding us back in the sense of choosing problems that we can go after with the systems. So in summary, it's coming. Please plan for it. And realize that there's a lot of news coming across. And start just thinking about quantum computing and how it can help you improve your world. Thank you.
Thank you so very much for that fascinating look at what is in store, hopefully sooner rather than later. We do have a couple of questions that have come in, so okay. I'll just start passing them over. First one is this: given the current concerns over increasing energy consumption of cloud computing, what does the energy efficiency look like?
So quantum computers are very energy efficient, so that big quantum computer you saw probably uses 10 regular power outlets, so it's very energy efficient. A lot of companies with huge data centers very much want to move to quantum simply because of the energy savings.
Very interesting. Okay, thank you. How do you make sure that quantum computing is not used to do evil?
So this is the problem here. Is with quantum's ability to break current encryption standards, there's a great side in that it can develop applications, and there's also a side that's a bit of a threat where it can break encryption standards. So what we're trying to do in the industry is move people along to start making the choices to protect their data so that we mitigate any potential problems.
Okay. Next question, what critical raw materials do you need to build quantum computers and in what amounts?
Right now we don't need a lot of amounts of raw materials. So when I talked about us heating up an element, it's literally a couple grams of element. It's nothing really big. Some of the larger quantum computers have giant cooling systems that use like liquid helium. That is something that's in shorter supply. So it may ultimately be that a quantum computer becomes the best simply because they have less materials requirements or less requirements for materials that are hard to get.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you very much. To what extent are quantum computers already being used by businesses? And what would be your guess when quantum computing will be used by generic businesses? 5 years, 10, 50, asks are.
So right now we're seeing a lot of quantum computing in banks, in automotive, in materials and chemistry. Those are the kind of early adopters. I still think solutions are at a minimum 5 years away, probably more likely 10, 12. And for just kind of a general usage where you would say, I want to buy this software package and it runs on a quantum computer, that's probably, I'm going to say, 10 to 15 years away.
Okay, but those are time spaces of time that are actually conceivable compared to what we were talking about even 10 or 15 years ago.
Yes.
Yeah, fascinating. We could take another live question from the room. Yes, here in the front, and a couple in the back. So I'm going to ask for super quick questions, if you don't mind, and I think I'll bundle them. Go ahead, please.
Thank you so much. Now, one observation. I had the opportunity to look at a quantum computing firm, and there was just sort of ancillary services around $60 million. And guess what? The valuation of the fundraising was at $2.8 billion for something that is 10 years away from us. My question is, though, do you fear we cannot control these quantum computers at some point?
Okay, we're going to bundle, so just control. Back here, I think we had another question. Do you have a mic yet?
Yeah, but mine was not a question. I wanted to share something. So I wanted to share and thank you for the topic that you are having women, and you inspire women to do the topic, because we just had our first employee that we hired, and we ran an AI on the job description, and it was saying, please remove quantum computing because women are not attracted by the topic. And that's why I wanted to share, and thank you so much for enabling women to do the topic.
Thank you very much for that. I just, we're forgetting to tell our speaker who everybody is. So I believe you're from Mac, is that right? And this other lady who asked about control is managing a family office, as
okay.
I remember. So back here, I have two more. Quickly, please.
Yeah, hi. You mentioned that Feynman invented the whole field by saying we should mimic nature. So given that you're also in biology and not just a quantum or physics researcher, what is known or what do you personally speculate about quantum processes within our brains?
I love that question.
Okay, well, let's do those two first, the control and that one, and then we'll move on. And that was Bea Knecht who spoke earlier, I believe. Is that right? You're kind of blocked. Yeah, okay, go on.
So there are some very high valuations right now for quantum computing companies. The companies that have just recently SPAC'd are having valuations in the area of $2 to $3 billion. There was just a very negative downseller report on quantum computing, so the valuations have gone down. But we still feel that because of the potential of the industry, that while the valuations seem high, there is a potential for great return. So I generally support the high valuations. Your second part of your question is, how do we control them? I think ethics in computing is a huge question, and we have yet to really put together ethics for computing of any sort, so whether it's classical or quantum. And so I think that is an important question. With respect to, are our brains quantum? Yeah, sure, they are. Actually, there's some very interesting research being done right now at UCLA, where they're starting to study, actually in birds, how birds use quantum sensing and quantum capabilities to find out where they are and to migrate and stuff. So this is just the beginning of some really great research.
Yeah, that's amazing. Go on, please. I think I have another one back here. Yeah. I see still a lot more. So again, tell us who you are and keep your questions super short, please.
Great.
Thanks.
Hi, I'm Karen Weaver from NYU in the United States. Thank you so much, Denise, for your presentation. I was particularly struck by how you pointed out the innovation that's taking place. And you mentioned your founder, who during graduate school was thinking about the evolution. Excuse me. And I want to know if you can talk a little bit more about how do we cultivate greater innovation and interest in quantum computing, particularly as it relates to women. And I'm thinking about that pipeline and pathway from graduate school, innovation with new businesses, et cetera. Thank you.
Thank you. And I'll take one more again, bundled. So in the back, yeah.
Yeah. Hello. Thank you, Denise, for a great presentation. So my name is Renata Jovanovic. I also have a similar background, chemical engineer, IBM, quantum computing, and another company. So it's lovely to see a female presenter and room full of females interested in the topic. And I just want to say there are possibilities. If you're in STEM, you're in a perfect position to start QSTEM, which is quantum STEM. And Denise, question for you, you're always saying, we don't know yet, and I know we don't know which modality will win. What is your personal perception? You've been in IBM, you're now in an atom, neutral atom area. So any kind of wild gut guesses?
Okay, she's trying to get it out of you. One more back here, and then then that's it. Go ahead, please.
Hi, Denise, Martina here. Amazing speech, so thanks for that. Given that we had the panel earlier about the complexity of solving the sustainability problem in cities, understanding that quantum computing solving complex problems, why has it not yet evolved as a field where it's being applied? Has it to do with the complexity of governance, city governance?
Okay, thank you. So we've got innovation, okay. We've got obstacles, and essentially that relates also to the timing question.
So the question on cities is very good, and I think it's a longer term solution that the quantum computers just aren't where they need to be, that they can really help. And so that is something I know in Germany we have cities looking at the power grid and how to optimize power grid. So it's kind of starting, but it's still a number of years away. With respect to innovation and women, I'll get on my soapbox. I do run this organization of 9,000 women, and that is one of the things that we work on is how to help women on their journey, how to help them kind of think and innovate and become really invested in a STEM career, which is a little bit more difficult. Not all of us are really raised to have STEM careers, so that's something we're very much trying to change. IBM's doing a really good job. There's also organizations I've spoken to a couple people about that we work with high school students and try to get them interested in STEM. And the third question.
Timing, your guess.
Timing, technology. What do I think is the leading technology? So scaling is very important. So when I look at the current technologies, which are superconducting and trapped ion, they're wonderful technologies. They've shown that quantum computing can exist. My question is, how do you go to 1,000 qubits or 1,000,000 qubits? And that's where I feel these secondary technologies like what we're working on, neutral atom, or photonics, or any number of other technologies have much more promise. So I think the first wave is very strong, but as we grow and really try to scale, I think these other technologies are going to achieve prominence.
Thank you so much. Denise Ruffner, amazing presentation. Thank you.